welcome to another edition of Filmnut. I am your host, Jeff Schubert. Glad you can join us for tonight's show. To catch up on past episodes, you can go to thestream.tv/filmnut, and you can follow us on Twitter by going to @thefilmnut. When it comes to filmmaking, comedies can be a difficult genre to succeed in. They present unique challenges when it comes to writing, acting, and editing, and maybe more than anything, marketing and selling them. My guest tonight, Stephen J. Wolfe, is a very successful producer and CEO for Sneak Preview Entertainment. With the comedies 500 Days of Summer, starring Joseph Gordon-Levitt and Zoey, Deschanel, Our Family Wedding, starring Forrest Whitaker and Carlos Mencia, and currently in production with The Secret Lives of Dorks, starring James Belushi, Vanessa Morano, Beau Murchoff, and Jennifer Tilly. Stephen J. Wolfe, welcome to Filmnut.
Be here.
Very nice to have you on. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
You know, as I alluded to in my introduction, as long as I've been around filmmaking on this end of things, trying to make it myself with films, I always hear how tough comedies are because what's funny in one part of the country might not be funny in another part of the country,
right,
let alone another part of the world. And now more than ever, with foreign receipts being very important in terms of recouping your investment and profiting in films, it's even more so than ever, and you're very successful with comedies. Is it hard, or what's your process, or what's your secret to success?
I don't know that I have a secret, really. It's kind of funny that you pick up on comedies, because I've done so many different kinds of movies, but I do really like comedies. For a long while, years ago, I was on a really dark street doing really serious, dark movies, and you know, I like comedies, but really, bottom line is it comes down to subject matters that I think are interesting, and when I'm reading something, if it makes me laugh out loud when I'm reading it, you know, I get really moved by it and have a great time and am attracted to that kind of material.
So that's the first step in the process, reading it, and if it makes you laugh out loud.
Well, you know, with any kind of film, being moved by it one way or another. If I read a script and I am constantly thinking about other things and, you know, what time is dinner, I need to go blow my nose,
right,
that's not a good sign. I mean, you know, if I'm being moved by something strongly in one way or another, whether that be laughing out loud, it grips me with suspense, it moves me emotionally, I'm crying. You know, that's the first step for me. I want to feel something when I read something, and when I go to the movies, you know, that's what I want too. So I really, it's all about what I like to see, quite honestly.
Fair enough. Staying with comedies then, you get a comedy that you like, a script that makes you laugh out loud, as you say.
Mm-hmm.
So then what is your process to getting other people excited about it, investors and talent?
Well, it starts with me being excited, like
okay,
I said, and if I'm excited, that's the first step, but then I also have to sort of kind of see a light at the end of the tunnel when I'm reading it. You know, it's like when I read something that I know I'm going to be interested in making, I usually will end up kind of starting to see certain actors in it. I'll start to see an audience for it. I'll have like a first step of what I would do to get it made.
And what would that be?
And, you know, it's different in every instance.
So
but it might be, oh, wow, you know, I just read this. You know, I think I mentioned to you earlier, I've worked with an actress named Jennifer Tilly many times in my career. We're good friends, and we've done about 8 films together. So maybe I read it, and I think, oh, my God, Jennifer would be so great in this part. I could see her, you know, playing it. Then if Jennifer does it, you know, so-and-so might want to do it. And, you know, or I might start thinking about somebody I want to partner with as another producer. Some of it obviously has to do with who's going to direct it. Many scripts come to me with a director already attached, or it's a writer-director, that kind of thing. But then others are things that don't have someone attached, or some of them are things that we actually develop ourselves from idea. So there's no real particular one way. But you start to formulate a game plan, and if those wheels don't start turning, then it's probably not going to be a script that I'm going to be interested in making.
Well, as you mentioned, you have done an eclectic mix of films.
Mm-hmm.
So is my premise incorrect? Has the comedies been any harder or easier to put together, or the comedy factor hasn't been an obstacle for you?
No, I don't think that it even weighs into how difficult it is to put a movie together. You know, that part of it is more about what happens in the process of making the movie. I actually think the hardest movies to get made, and especially in today's climate, are dramas. I think they're infinitely harder to get made. They're not harder movies to do or to physically produce.
Right.
But to actually get you know, someone who wants to fund them or someone who wants to distribute them, way harder. You know, people like to laugh, people like to be entertained. We're also in a climate right now where people like uplifting stories and they want a little bit of escape from their daily life. So it's actually harder to make serious films, I think, personally.
Well, let's pick one of your films in particular, 500 Days of Summer, mm-hmm. Very funny. So right off the bat then with this script, it made you laugh out loud. And then how did you get it made from there? Did you get the money first? Did you get the talent first?
Well, that's in that particular case, that's a movie that was actually brought to me by the studio, and it was already packaged. Potentially financed. There were a couple of producers attached and a director attached at the time I read it. And Searchlight was looking for another producer to bring on board for the producing team, and the film had been budgeted much higher, and no one actually could sort of figure out a plan at that point of how to really get the film made within the kind of budget they were willing to green light. And I read it. I was doing another picture at Searchlight at the time, and I read it, and I just fell in love with it when I read it. I mean, you know, not only was it funny, but it was moving. The characters were characters that you could really identify with, and the storytelling was unique. So, I mean, there were just so many great elements about that script. I read it, and it was like I couldn't wait to call and say, I want to be involved in this film, you know. And fortunately, that all came together.
Yeah, you know, one of the things I noticed about your comedies that I've watched was the writing is very crisp, and the acting, these are specifically defined characters where the acting is really good, and you believe the position that they're representing, right? In 500 Days, you had kind of the juxtaposition of the guy being the one who really wanted the deep, committed relationship.
Right.
And the female who was the detached, not believing in love.
Right.
And they were so well performing their characters, you believe them in that particular space that made the lines work.
Right.
They don't
work. Well, and not only that, but I think along with that is it was a very universal story about love, and I think everybody in their lives at one point or another have been one of those two people, man or woman,
right,
in a relationship. And, you know, we would all joke about that while we were making it when, you know, we would ask people, you know, were you this character when you read it or were you this character? And, you know, there was always one that somebody would identify with stronger. But it's true, you know, the traditional roles were switched in that. And Tom, the Joseph Gordon-Levitt role, had more of a female perspective, or what's traditionally a female perspective on love. You know, in general, because I like very character-driven movies, I'm attracted to things that are primarily about real people. The comedy comes from putting them in maybe absurd situations, like, you know, reversing roles like that, or you know, putting seemingly normal people in an absurd or abnormal situation. You know, that's a particular kind of comedy I like.
That's great comedy, and traditionally you see a lot of that in sitcoms on mm-hmm. TV, because things are funny not necessarily because of the lines themselves, but because they're happening to George, if we're talking
right.
about Seinfeld, or because they're happening to Norm, if you're talking
I grew up a Lucy fan. I mean, I probably, you know, saw every single I Love Lucy episode, you know, 75 times. So that, you know, was a kind of comedy that that I identified with, and it was very simple. Mm-hmm. You know, it was a housewife and a husband, and, you know, struggling to make it in their relationship and in their careers and in homemaking, and they were regular people put into very absurd situations.
Yeah, and it's just, you know, it's just that much harder to do in a film because you don't have, you know, seasons and past episodes,
right.
which to build, you have to do it right away.
Right.
So it was something I picked up on. Great job in your films. Let's check in with the chat room for the first time tonight. And let's see, Dark Side of the Force would like to ask, you kind of answered this with 500 Days, but let's see how we apply it to another one. When do your films get distribution? Before they're made, after, at film festivals?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Good question. Dark Side of the Force. Every one of them is different, to tell you the truth. I mean, there's been a few select films that I've made where there was distribution before, but most of them were either picked up out of festivals, a lot of my films have been in festivals, or they were picked up somewhere along the way in the process.
So privately financed then?
You know, all different kind. I mean, I've done lots of privately financed movies. I've done movies that were what we call split rights deals. Maybe we had a video deal and a couple of foreign territories. The film that I'm completing right now, The Secret Lives of Dorks, was partially financed by my company and two other partners' companies. And then we pre-sold some foreign rights. And then we also raised money from private investors. So that was like a combination, and then that's a film that'll get sold when it's complete.
Is it, speaking of the times now with the comedy or films in general and the current economy, how is it out there raising money for films?
It's hard, but you know, it's always been hard. I mean, I've been in the business a really long time, and I remember in the early 80s when I started and I was, you know, really wide-eyed and bushy-tailed, and you would hear stories about the death of independent film was just right around the corner, and you know, everybody was going bankrupt, and there was this problem or that problem, and I was scared. I mean, I was like, you know, 22 years old, and I had picked this profession, and I'm going, oh my God, I mean, in a couple of years, it's not going to exist anymore. You know, well, 30 years later, here we are, and it's this, you know, it's like the news in general, quite honestly. If you pick up a newspaper from 1904, you'll read a lot of the same doom and gloom that we read in the paper today. It's just a little bit easier to get to that news today, and it's more widespread. But, you know, I'm driven by good material, and if I'm passionate about it, I don't think about all that. I just think about, you know, what do I need to do today to move this project forward? And I'm usually working on 8 or 10 of them at once. And, you know, and I have to be passionate enough about every single one of them because I need to be thinking about them every day. And, you know, constantly I'm sitting at my desk and I'm typing emails and this and that. And I'm going, oh, there's a script that I'm working on. I should send it to so-and-so, you know. And then I answer a few more emails. And then, you know, I'll ask my assistant, whatever happened with this project? Has so-and-so read it yet? We have to follow up. And you're constantly switching gears like that.
And there's a rotation of people coming in and out, but there are still people out there with which to pitch and make your projects
and,
with.
You know, and you have to try and keep up on that and, you know, and socializing and in the news and all that kind of thing. But bottom line is, you know, I just show up every day and try and do the best as I can and not worry about the doom and gloom. So movies are still getting made. You have to adapt with the times. You know, I think you have to look at trends and, you know, you have to say, okay, well, a particular kind of movie in today's market, you can't necessarily spend on it what you could maybe 3 years ago or 5 years ago because, you know, maybe the video dollars aren't as big or this or that. I mean, you have to adapt what you're doing. But it's always hard to get money for movies. It will probably always be hard to get money for movies. And you just, you know, you have to be driven by your passion for the material.
No, it's very funny what you say about, you know, reading about those doom and gloom stories since 84. Because it seems like, yeah, all media is cyclical. Mm-hmm. Like you can count on in sports there being a story about expanding replay, you know,
right.
You know,
right.
Instant replay. It just recycles. And, and with independent film, you're certainly right about two things. The death of independent film is written about almost on a yearly basis.
All the time. Until there's a giant hit and one of the studios buys a $1 million movie for $10 million. Right. Then all of a sudden, everybody's back on the bandwagon.
And independent films are being made every year.
Yes.
Right?
So there's this. Exactly.
Let's get to another chat room question. Senior Shutter, I am a big fan of The Civilization of Maxwell Bright. Was it hard to get that film financed considering it doesn't have a happy ending?
Hi, Senior Shutter. I'm glad you asked about that film because it's one of my favorites that I did. That was a film that was written and directed by a filmmaker named David Beard, who I have known actually since the beginning of my career. I worked as a prop assistant on his first feature in 1981. That was one of my first jobs. And it was something that David wrote. We had been in touch many times over the years, and we actually worked on a couple other films previous to that, and he had me read it one day, and you know, that was a film that I just flipped out when I read it. And it was extremely funny and unconventional. You know, for those of you who haven't seen it, it's a pretty in-your-face movie about a misogynist who's particularly horrible to women. And the movie starts out with him just on a tirade. And, you know, it was probably one of the funniest scripts I had read, but also emotionally moving scripts I had read. And that was another example of a movie where, you know, my company partially financed it. The director put up a lot of the money himself for it. We raised money with other private investors, and amazing actors came to work on that movie. Jennifer Tilly and Eric Roberts, and Patrick Warburton plays the lead, and he's brilliant in it. And it was something that we all worked really, really hard on, and it got a lot of awards out there. And I think it's run on the Sundance Channel, and it's available on home video and all that kind of thing. But it was a great experience, great experience.
Good question, Senior Shutter. Thank you.
Yeah.
Now, speaking of scripts that make you laugh out loud or that affect you emotionally, where do you get them? Do they come to you through agents, managers? How does one?
There is never a problem getting a script. No. There is always a script.
But will you only look at scripts?
There's scripts, 500 of them a day on email. They come from friends, from managers, from everybody and anybody. But so there's never a problem getting a script. But to really answer your question, generally, I read scripts only from people I know. It takes a lot for me to pick up an unsolicited script. Right. So, you know, mostly from filmmakers, from actors. A lot of times I get projects that are pet projects of an actor or something like that, or they have told me about it. In the case of Maxwell Bright, that was a filmmaker I had worked with several times. Agents, get a lot of things from agents, managers, lawyers that I work with, studios, sometimes from studios, it's, you know, from relationships. Anything I read has to come from some sort of relationship.
Quick question. You gave me your specific answer, but maybe you can give a general answer, because maybe it's not something that you do, but mm-hmm. you might still see some value in it. There are these companies where writers can pay to have their scripts, I think Inktip might be one of them, mm-hmm. where they can put their script online, a little bit of a synopsis, this, that, and the other, and supposedly managers and producers are going through it looking for stuff. Are you aware of them, and do you have any opinion on them?
I'm aware of them, and some people may. I don't utilize them. Sometimes I think about it, you know, because it's kind of fun to discover new talent. I really enjoy that process, but the realities of my day don't really allow me much time to look at things like that. So, you know, like I get a list of new projects from up and coming writers or directors from the Film Independent. Threw me for a minute because they changed their name a few years ago, but from Film Independent, I'll look at those. But even those, I'll carry that booklet around sometimes for 4 months before I have time to look at it. And I do that specifically because it's fun to find new people. But I also can easily do that through networking with people I know, because there's always somebody who will say, oh, you know, I just met this young filmmaker, or, you know, I see things at festivals. A lot of times that's a place to see up-and-coming talent.
Filmmakers, so you'll see a filmmaker at a festival. A completed film, and then see what else.
Yeah, or a short film. You know, sometimes I'll see a short film that I really like, and I'll meet somebody at a festival or something like that.
What about pitch festivals and screenplay competitions?
Not something I really, you know, have seen too much of, but you know, I can't say that there's anything wrong with doing
them. Right. Yeah, it's just your personal.
It's just for me.
What
and,
do you do?
You know, I hate to admit this, but I don't like to read. but I do. You know, there's always a script to read, so I sort of feel like, you know, I can only go. There's only so much I can look at, and you got to give preference.
Sure.
You know, basically.
Now we did. We brought a clip, or you brought a clip, I should say. Thank you very much. From 500 Days of Summer.
Oh, you're welcome.
I want to set it up real quick because one of the
YouTube brought a clip from 500 Days of Summer.
There you go.
Yeah. Okay.
Thanks to them, because I wanted to ask you a question about this particular scene because it seemed rather complicated, and in 500 Days of Summer. We're talking about a script with some good characters, but by and large carried by its two leads, if you will.
Right.
And it's a dialogue, character-driven piece. But yet, in the middle of it, there's this really complicated scene with lots of extras and so forth. And I wanted to ask you about
the musical number, of
musical
course.
Number
yeah.
and pulling it off and so forth. So that's the setup. Let's go ahead and take a look at it, and then we'll talk about what went into executing it.
Sure. On a night.
And shout my wife out and wrap yourself. you go. So as I was saying before we went into it, mostly a character-driven. I'm sorry.
It's still fun to look at.
Yeah. And right before that, there's this great bit where he's like looking in the mirror and he doesn't see himself. He sees Han Solo. That's very funny the way that happens. So what happened right before that scene, just so the audience knows that and why this is all happening, and then why that scene? It seemed like a big budget scene for a mostly character-driven two-person piece.
You know, it was one of the charming things about the script, quite honestly. I mean, that's, you know, Tom's kind of, it's his internal reality of how great it feels to finally get a chance to be with a woman he's been in love with for so long, you know? So it's really in his imagination. It's not really happening.
Right.
But, and there was actually two of those numbers in the movie originally. There was this one, and then there was another version of the same song that's a sad version when things aren't going so well in Tom's relationship. So, but it wasn't necessary when we cut the film together. One was enough. But that was one of the many things that made me want to do the movie when I read it. I mean, it was just a great moment.
Was it a very different day because you had all these extras and all that stuff going on?
Well, it was just bigger production-wise. I mean, every day is difficult, but there was a lot of logistics. We were doing a fairly small budget movie. I mean, it was an $8 million movie, so there was it's a big movie for how little dollars we had, and you know, every minute of the way we were scrimping and saving to make sure that when it came to be that day, I mean, I was keeping like little charts I was looking at to see how many dancers would we in fact be able to have for that scene, you know, I'm trying to remember, but I think it was shot, it was maybe over the halfway point of when we finished the film. I can't remember entirely. I don't think he showed in the clip, but there's a great moment where Tom is walking by the lower street in front of the music center, and he goes by where the big giant fountain is, which is not on. And you know, and the fountain comes bursting on in the middle, which was like a lot of coordinating. I mean, you know, and it was like we found that location, and I don't remember if the director had that idea. What that particular item wasn't scripted, from what I remember, but you know, I think he thought it would be a great idea if the fountain came on in the middle, and that was like, well, how many engineers is it going to take, and can we get them there? I think we were shooting that on a Sunday, if I remember, because we wanted to shoot when there was less people around, or we had to shoot, actually, something like that, when there was less people around downtown. So, you know, there was engineers, there was a lot of special equipment, special lighting equipment, cranes were involved to get some of the high angles, but also to place some of the lighting, and even though it's a day exterior, there was a lot of lighting that was necessary for the sequence. And then, of course, we had a marching band, and there was special costumes. I mean, it was one of the biggest sort of creative costume areas of, you know, in the movie, and choreography, all of which had to be rehearsed in advance. A lot of elements there. And Joe is so good at what he does in that scene, and you know, he was rehearsing kind of in between every other thing we were doing for days leading up to that. The minute he had a break for 15 minutes, he'd go out into a parking lot with the choreographer and they'd rehearse it. And then he'd go running back in. And, you know, it was, we didn't have a lot of time, quite honestly. And that was all, both musical sequences were shot in one day. So there was not a lot of time to shoot that.
Well, it was very well executed. And there was, just like the water fountain going on and off, there was so much cleverness in this particular comedy. I think we talked about it beforehand. There's a scene where the lead character, he's going to see his girlfriend, or who he wants to be his girlfriend, and we see a split screen of the expectation of what's going to happen, and then we see the reality of what actually happens.
Which also, by the way, was in the script. A lot of people ask me, like, you know, was the manner of the storytelling created in the script, or was it all editorial? And, you know, and we had a brilliant editor on the movie, and we had amazing screenwriters and a very talented director and also cinematographer. But it was all in the script. And then, you know, and then a director who really had a vision and knew how to carry it out. And that scene you're talking about is one of the best scenes in the movie. And it's so effective. But it was, you know, it was a lot of orchestrating to make sure that as each of those cameras was moving, and it's not all one shot, but it's close to. And as the two shots merged together, you know, people had to be at the right place at the right time. And as things are being revealed, it was a lot of careful planning. And I really credit Mark Webb for really knowing what he wanted to do and having an amazing vision.
Well, to be honest, as I'm watching it, I liked it right away, the effect, the doing of that. And I was like surprised at how long it went on, mm-hmm. and it maintained its strength,
right.
You know, the whole way through. It was perfect. Well,
it's so, again, it's imagination, because that's why so many people identify with that kind of thing, because, you know, there is the reality,
right.
And then there is what we all think it's going to be, the
right.
Anticipation of what a key moment in our life is going to be, no matter what it is, whatever moment that is. You think about it, and you think about it, and you have an idea of what it's going to be like. And you may even play it differently for yourself than what it actually is in reality.
Well, I think when you talk about the relatability that we all have, all having been one or the other in that scenario,
right.
That's like a great payoff, because we've all done that. You know, we've all lived that. I should say, the few blessed ones who haven't, but basically right. Everyone's been in that scenario where the reality didn't meet the expected, so
yeah.
It was fun. I want to check in with the chat room and see what we have. Movie Matt would like to ask, I have a question. Will there be a 500 Days number 2?
Hi, Movie Matt. So far nobody's talked about it. It's not impossible, but I think I think the story's been told, and it almost would do this movie a disservice to do another one, quite honestly, but you never know. It made a lot of money. So
there you go. Now, you're currently in production with The Secret Lives of Dorks.
Yes.
And what is that about? And I think we have some stills to show from that.
Yes. The Secret Lives of Dorks is a high school romance about a dorky kid who has his eyes on the head, the school's cheerleader, and a girl he's never going to get. And it's really about how he slowly falls for the other dorky girl at school, quite honestly.
There you go. Now that in and of itself, you know, it doesn't sound like something that's never been done before, but because you have such an amazing track record with me now, with the work of yours, I can't wait to see it, because I'm sure it's not going to be just typical.
There's only so many stories out there.
Right.
And it's all about the way we tell the story. And this is, you know, the kid who's the lead of this movie, Galen Connell.
What are we looking at?
That is Jennifer Tilly, who is a loved, crazed teacher who has her eyes for Jim Belushi, who's the lead character's dad, a football coach at school.
And what stage of production are we?
We are in the last stages of post-production. We have a little additional material that we're going to be filming shortly, and then we'll be finishing it up probably September, October.
And is this one that you have distribution for that you'll be going to festivals
for? This
will
be one we'll be going out to sell.
You'll be going.
We have some distribution. We have foreign sales already taken care of on this. Our domestic deal will be done when we launch the film.
Now, you talk about adapting to the times. What would you, because of social media and all that sort of thing, is there anything that you would do differently with this film than, say, a film 10 years ago? Is the plan the same? Sundance and whatever?
I mean, we already have a website, thedorksmovie.com. And we have a Twitter site, and we're starting to build a social media and a web presence. That's something we never would have done, you know, when I started in the business. We didn't even have internet then. So,
but do you use that to sell it, to get that domestic?
It's to build early awareness and to hopefully help show distributors that there's interest in it. So, for those of you watching, please log on and let us know that you're interested in seeing this movie. But it's all part of what you have to do now. You have to start to build that. It's a tool that we didn't have and that we can use today, and why not use it?
Now, on that website, say it one more time for the audience.
TheDorksMovie.com.
TheDorksMovie.com. There's a blog there, and one thing I saw on there was it said to make it in Hollywood, you have to do like one or two things. You either have to know someone in Hollywood, or you have to show up and be awesome. Now, personally, I can think of a third way to make it in Hollywood, but that's not important for the purposes of this interview.
Okay.
But what does, I just want to ask you, what does show up and be awesome mean to you?
You know, to me, that's like, you really have to live and breathe what you're doing to make it in our business and to have any longevity. You've got to be passionate. You have to be well connected to your work, you know, emotionally invested in your work, and you have to live it and breathe it. And it has to be really important to you, and you have to care about it, you know, pretty much every day.
Now, a common answer that I get on this show when I talk about what's the most important part or what's the most underappreciated part, no matter how I phrase it, the answer inevitably comes back, the script and the story and all that sort of stuff. And, and you were talking about it earlier in this interview.
I'll probably say the same thing.
Well, what I want to ask you, though, is how long does it take to get that great script? Because you talk about, you know, show up and be awesome, how committed you have to be to write a great script. Is it that first draft that you write in 2 to 4 weeks? Or,
you know, there is no rule to that. You know, I think that if I remember, 500 Days of Summer was written pretty quickly, and the guys didn't think anybody would be interested in it. It was more a cathartic experience. You know, I've worked on projects. I did a family comedy a few years ago called The Dennis the Menace Christmas. It was a sequel to the Dennis the Menace movies, and you know, there was a script that went fast. I mean, we developed it from an idea stage, and Warner Brothers was involved in it. This was one not typical, but this one we had the money before we had an idea, and we had the money, and we had the distribution, and all we had to do was go out and execute the idea, and that was great. You know,
so developing a great script can be as little as a few weeks, or it can take a couple of years.
Yeah, you know, it took a long time to get to the position where they were ready to go on it. You know, it was an idea, and it was like literally two years of, you know, checking in and pushing that along. But once they said, yes, we want to do this, then we went out and the writers wrote the script in 2 to 3 months, and it happened to be good.
And then when the directors and producers get involved, how much do you continue to tweak and
that
develop?
Particular one, it was tweaked. You know, every single project is tweaked as long as you can tweak it,
right.
Bottom line, you know, but nothing unusual. But, you know, generally, you know, if a film gets made within 3 years from the time I read it, then I think it's fast and great. And even in the I think the fastest, even films that have come to me from studios where they're going to finance them, probably the fastest is a year to a year and a half from the time I actually read it to when we were making it.
That's a good answer.
But you know, I read The Secret Lives of Dorks 6 years ago. Some of it was because you're working on so many things, you don't have time. I mean, you know, maybe if I had all day every day to devote to getting that movie made, it would have been made in a year. But the fact of the matter is, I read it, and then I had other things to do, and I had partners on it, and they had other things to do, and, you know, and we all just kept working on it and pushing it along, and there was a few financing scenarios that fell through along the way, which is very typical, and eventually it got made.
I want to ask you a question about Our Family Wedding, because I was looking on some message boards. I think one in particular was on IMDb, and I thought it was a very funny movie, very well done. And there were people talking about it, maybe implying that it may have been a little too racist or racial kind of thing. Were you aware of that critique, if you will, and what are your thoughts on it?
I've read a little bit about it on IMDb. You know, certainly we had no intent to portray anything racist, and you know, we all worked extremely hard to portray something that we thought was realistic, at least from an emotional standpoint. And you know, there are some jokes that are based on stereotypes, and you know, but stereotypes oftentimes are funny because they're stereotypes, and we all have to laugh at ourselves at times, you know, so that's okay. But none of those jokes certainly had any intent of being racist. They're just, you know, they're just a humorous poke at something a particular culture does. And they certainly were laughing in the theaters when they saw it, so.
I thought it was, those comments are completely unwarranted. It's very apparent that it is not the position of the film or the filmmakers to try to make any sort of serious statement, you know, that these things were true.
Right.
I think in our times, there's, you know, when you're sending something out to a mass audience, there will always be people that either A, take offense, or B, comment just based on a premise without even having maybe even seen the work.
Right.
You know, that happens too.
That can happen.
But I go with the South Park theory. I don't know if you're familiar with that show.
Yes.
So long as you're going at everyone and you're doing it equally and it's all fair. And
exactly.
It's all well and good, then it's all good.
I agree.
You know, both sides with the, you know, the races involved, the Mexicans and the African Americans,
they would go,
in a fun way.
Stereotypes come from sort of repeat behavior in certain aspects of life. So, you know, I think quite honestly, it's sometimes it's just fun to laugh at those stereotypes.
Yeah. Wasn't mean-spirited. They come together at the end. It's very happy.
Yeah.
You know, it's all good. Let's get to another question from the IM board as we begin to wrap up. Sinister31 would like to ask, what is an obstacle that occurred on one of your films after filming began, and how did you deal with it? So maybe a challenge in production or something?
Oh, hi, Sinister. How you doing? One of the first films that I produced when I started my company many years ago was a movie called Tollbooth with a writer-director named Salome Bresner, who actually, coincidentally, is the director of The Secret Lives of Dorks. We were probably, I think, 10 days away from shooting the film, and the key part of the financing fell through, and we were making that movie in the Florida Keys. We had a large cast of great actors like Louise Fletcher and Lenny Van Dolen and Fruza Balk, who was a really hot actress at the time, and we were so lucky to have her, and the money fell through, and we had to decide, what are we going to do? Are we going to let people know, or are we going to stop? And, you know, we were so passionate about this film that we just kept going. And, you know, and while we were making the film, I was on the phone, you know, every hour that I wasn't on set, and most hours through the night, trying to find more money for that movie. And we kept it going, and the movie got made.
Great. Two more questions, then I want to get you out of here. One is on Miss March, a very funny movie. Your lead actors were your writers and directors. So how is that being the producer and working with them? Very funny movie.
Thank you. I actually love that movie. It was really definitely not politically correct.
So it's Zach Gregger and Trevor Moore.
Yes, the Whitest Kids You Know, or two of the guys from The Whitest Kids You Know. It was a great experience. It was a logistically challenging, like immensely challenging film, because it was also a low budget film, which seems to be a repeat in my in my life, but more work to do than dollars to go around, but very logistically challenged. I mean, we were shooting, we had stunts with fire engines, we had a fire sequence in the movie, we had to recreate the Playboy Mansion elsewhere, and we actually shot in the Playboy Mansion, but a lot of the Playboy Mansion wasn't in the Playboy Mansion, and a lot of actors. It was a road movie, and it was shot in, if I remember, 24, 25 days. It was really challenging. But the guys were great. I mean, always a great, you know, great energy on set. They are truly really, really funny guys. I mean, you know, they think funny, and what comes out of their mouth is funny. But total professionals,
they reacted off each other great.
Yeah, you know, and they already had worked together for so long. They had a great chemistry together. You know, they didn't have to really work that part of it. It was more for them. It was probably a lot harder than it was for me as a producer, because you know, they had all the regular acting chores, but then they had to figure out how to direct it too.
And Craig Robinson, very funny in the movie.
He was hysterical. Yeah. I'm trying to think of his character name, Dot MPEG.
Dot MPEG.
The rapper.
Yeah. Very funny. Well, I would definitely recommend to the audience you check out all the comedies we talked about tonight, 500 Days of Summer, Our Family Wedding, and Miss March, and of course, look out for Secret Lives of Dorks. And one more time, the website.
TheDorksMovie.com.
Okay, and the question we do like to get people out of here on is, do you have a favorite set speak term, like back to one or checking the gate?
It's a wrap.
It's a wrap.
Because I know we got the day's work.
Spoken like a producer.
Exactly.
Very good. Well, thank you so much for coming in tonight.
All right.
Appreciate talking
to you.
Thank you. We will see you next time on Filmnut. And once again, thanks for tuning in.